Hello, and welcome to the CCF online channel. We are excited for you to be part of another worship experience. We pray that what you learn here today will deepen your relationship with Jesus. Enjoy the message.
By the way, I am Alan Butuyan, and the message that we'll be hearing from this day on is part of that mini-series which is Growing in Love. And today, it is very providential that God has assigned to me a passage that is very relevant to what's happening in our country, especially in the past or the recently concluded national election. And I believe that as children of God, the best source of information or the best reference that we're going to dig in is really the Word of God, so that we'll be able to understand how do we really relate to authorities. How do we submit to authorities over us? As children, as teeners, or 20 years, or senior citizen, if we believe that we have this relationship with God, how do we relate to the civil authorities or to those set on us by God? So last week, we have heard Pastor Bob preach about Psalm 19, which is really the importance of meditating on the Word of God. And in Psalm 19, we understood that the law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul, and the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. So it lifts up or enshrines the Word of God, the Scripture, the Bible as the source or the authority in our morals and conduct. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever, and the judgments of the Lord are true. They are righteous altogether. They are more desirable than gold, yes, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and keeping them, there is great reward. So, based on this foundational truth, we understand that the Bible will warn us and will reward us in everything that we do in relation to the world. Now, our main text this morning is taken from 1 Peter chapter 13 to chapter 2, verses 13 to 17 about relating to human authorities. So let us read this slowly, and then this is going to be where our message this morning will be taken from as we unpack the truth from these verses. So starting with verse 13, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. In verse 15, for such is the will of God, that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bondslaves of God. Honor all people, love the Lord, and love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the King. So this is our main verse, and the title of our message this morning is very, very simple based on these biblical verses. And the title is, Honor Authority, Be a Blessing. Can we read this together? Honor Authority, Be a Blessing. So when we honor authority, everything that is instituted by God, then we will be a blessing to those around us, to those away from us, and even to the entire nation. That is why this is our message this morning. So you may have some questions like, what if the authority is not according to my taste or is not according to my type? What if the government is weak? Or what if the government is authoritative? What if they are not discharging their duties as mandated upon them? Am I going to submit to them? Then let's ask the Bible, which is the eternal Word of God. Now let's have the context first. Before we understand chapter 2, verses 13 to 17, we don't have to get the meaning out of context, but we let the Scripture interpret itself. So the doctrine of The infallibility of the Word of God is the Scripture is infallible in itself because it will interpret itself. So we have to understand what is the context. So if we go many verses before 13, here is what Peter says. But you are a chosen race, a holy priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So Peter was talking to the believers. You are a peculiar people. You are a holy nation, a people that is possessed by God. So he has to let them understand that whatever things that he will be instructing them in practical terms or to be applied in life must have a theological basis. There must be a foundational basis before he will tell them to submit to authorities. And this is the basis because Christians are a chosen race. And then going on to verse 10, once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. So again, Peter was telling the believers, you are once not a people of God, but now you are set apart. You have become a people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. So if there are things that are troubling, there are things that are struggling inside your heart, the passions of the flesh, then you have to stay away from that. And then, here is now the bridge. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable. So what Peter is saying is because you are a chosen people, a holy nation, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood, then keep your conduct excellent, impeccable, nothing to be accused of. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles, meaning among the unbelieving world, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God. So when people will see that Christians are living a different kind of life as opposed to the world, when people will see that there is a distinction of this people, a holy nation, Christians, against the Gentile world, against the unbelievers, they will see the good deeds and then glorify God. So this is what Peter was saying. It must be clearly seen. It must be clearly visible for the glory of God. Because this is the command of Jesus Christ. In Matthew, he says, in the same way, let your light shine before others, or let your good deeds, your good works, the things that can be seen that are virtuous, anything that is praiseworthy, anything that is commendable, so that they may see your good works and what? Glory, and give glory to the Father who is in heaven. So Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:31, he said, whatever you do, whether you eat or drink, do it all for the glory of God. So whatever we do, and now this is the foundation before he moves into submission to authority. Now, the context of these verses is when Peter was talking about suffering, that we have to suffer when we do right. He said that it's no good when you suffer because of doing wrong, because you will not get anything from it, but you are commended by God when you suffer, when you are doing right. So in this whole book of this whole letter of Peter, he was saying that even in suffering, even in difficulty, people has to submit. And our main text will talk about submission to civil authorities, imperfect civil authorities. That is our main text in verses 13 to 17. And following that also is Peter talking to submission of slaves to cruel masters in verses 18 to 25. Having a sneak look at the verse, Peter said, servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. So he was saying, Christian slaves, Christian employees, Christian subordinates, you have to submit not only to the gentle, but also to the unjust masters. So that's the context. And then, another part of the letter of Peter, in verses 1 to 6 of chapter 3, submission of wives to unbelieving and unkind husbands. Meaning, if a woman is married to an unbeliever, Peter says something about submission. Okay, in verse 1 of chapter 3, likewise, wives, be subject to your husbands. Subject meaning submit, be under, so that even if some do not obey the word. So when you talk about some do not obey the word, meaning they are unbelievers, they are not sympathetic to the cause of Christ, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives when they see your respectful and pure conduct. So this is what Peter was talking about. So he was talking about submission to authorities, submission to cruel masters, and even to unbelieving husbands. And then, part four is, husbands to be considerate with their wives. So it's also possible that even as a husband, there is also a difficulty on his part to be considerate on the wife. Okay? It says there, likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way. So we have to be understanding to make room for the faults or mistakes of our wives, because it is showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. So this is now the entire context of Peter before he talks about, when he's talking about submission to authorities. Now we have here, as we continue with our word, we have here submission to authorities. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. So submit means, in the Greek word, it is a word hopotaxo, meaning to be subject to, to be under obedience to, voluntary subordination to others. So when you say you submit, there is someone above, and the submission is voluntarily. It's not begrudgingly or not compulsory because you are compelled, but voluntarily. That is what we mean by hopotazo or submit. And then, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution. So human institution talks about civil authorities. So in the original Greek, the word there is creation. So when we talk about submission to human institution, we can extend it further that people are to submit to anyone above them. So if you're a child under the roof of your parents, the authority above you are your parents. If you are a student in your classroom, the authority above you is your teacher. If you are an employee, the authority above you is, of course, your boss or your employer. In a church, even in a church, the authority above you when it comes to spiritual concerns are the church leaders. So human institution in this case is civil authorities in this context. And then, whether to a king as the one in authority or to governors as sent by him. So the governors are sent by the king. So what are these governors? We are not simply talking about elected governors of provinces, but we are simply saying civil servants who carry out the government functions. So if the president, he has the executive body, so every part of the executive body or the legislative body and even the judiciary, wherever you are part of this in the civil government, so everyone from the president down to the mayor, down to the governor, down to the councilor, down to the traffic enforcer, down to the tax collector, down to the regulating body like the treasury, the BIR, the building official, and everything, they are part of the government agents or governors as sent by the king. So Paul also says With pinpoint accuracy, he was also saying, confirming what Peter said, let every person be subject to governing authority. So here is the word, governing authority. So they have the function to govern. So they are authorized. For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Okay, what are these? Those instituted by God. Okay, we have to understand that those instituted by God, whether they are democratic, whether they are totalitarian, whether they are dictatorship, in the times of Paul and Peter, he was talking about Nero. That was in the year 54 to 68 AD. And Nero is a cruel tyrant. You remember there was a story or legends tells us that when Rome was burning, he was fiddling on the roof and then he blamed all the Christians because of the destruction of Rome. So he was talking, or Peter was talking, about honoring or submitting to civil authorities, honor the king. He was referring to Nero at that time. So regardless of whatever form of government, every Christian around the world, and we know that there are oppressive or repressive regime around the world, but wherever Christians are, they are to submit to the authorities. And because it is instituted by God, in Daniel chapter 2, verse 21, it tells us that God changes times and seasons and he removes kings and set up kings. So there are government leaders that are placed there by democratic means or by coup or by invasion or by invasion of one country to another, just like Babylon was conquered by Medo-Persia, and then Persia was conquered by Greece, and then Greece was conquered by the Romans, and whatever, and then governments are formed. So whatever form of government, it was always instituted by God. But this is not to tell us that God agreed with this government in what they do, but God permitted them to be instituted or to be established, because this is what the Word of God says. He removes kings and sets up kings. So the next question is, what is the primary ordained function of civil authorities? So we may ask, ano ba ang function ng civil authorities when it comes to my faith? How do I relate my faith to the civil authorities? So the Word of God tells us in verse 14, okay, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers. So that is one ordained function of the government, for the punishment of evildoers, and second, for the praise of those who do what is right. So one is to punish wrongdoers, and the other one is to praise those who do what is right. So if that is how we understand the government should be, then that is also what God expects the government to do. In verse 2 of chapter 13, Paul says, therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. So ito sinabi niya, those who resist will incur judgment. So when God established a government, however it was established, Christians are not encouraged to subvert any form of government. You know, during this time, when the Christians were blooming or they were expanding, and then of course there are oppressive regimes during that time, and then there is what we call the group of the zealots. So they are saying, we have to subvert this government. They have to subvert Rome during that time, because Rome is the power that exists during that time, and then the Jews are under Rome. So they're saying, in order for us to live free, then we have to subvert Roman authorities. We don't pay taxes to Roman authorities. That's why the Jews are either belligerent, or they are just submitting to Roman authority but with a heavy heart. But Paul was telling them, those who resist will incur judgment. And so he was telling Christians, no, that is not our work. We are not here to subvert government. And then Paul proceeded, for rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. So he was saying, rulers are placed not to punish the good, but only for those who are doing bad. And then he challenged, would you have no fear of the one who is on authority? Then do what is right, and you will receive his approval. So if you do what is right, you don't need to be afraid of those people in authority. But if you do what is wrong, if you are contemplating on doing a crime, then be afraid. We have to understand that the government should be like that. And then it says in another translation, in the New Living Translation, for authorities, do not strike in people who are doing right. Do not strike fear. So the authorities do not strike fear to those who are doing right. They strike fear to those who are really doing wrong. And sometimes I see this is operational when I saw one Facebook blog saying one of a gang somewhere in Luzon, they're saying that it's now time to stop what we're doing because instead of doing hold up or stealing or robbery or drugs like that, they have to stop already because the president is Duterte. They're saying like that. And this is actually what's happening here. No? So that's the function of the government. Okay? Would you like to live without fear of the authorities? Then do what is right and they will honor you. So as a Christian, we have to understand that when we do what is right, then we don't have problem with the government. But when we do wrong, then fear or terror must be in our hearts. Okay, the word fear comes from a Greek word phobos, in which the English word phobia comes. Arachnophobia, fear of spiders, acrophobia, fear of heights, or claustrophobia, fear of closed spaces. So this is the word. So terror or fright. So it is fear. So Albert Barnes says in one of his commentary, he says, fear is one of the means by which men are restrained from crime in a community. So people are afraid to commit crime when they fear the law. So if they fear the law because the law is exacted, the law is executed for those who will commit crime, then fear is really a tool. On many minds, it operates with much more power than any other motive, and it is one which a magistrate must make use to restrain men from evil. So this is one of the ordained function of the government, to restrain evil. And in order to protect those who are doing good, then there has to be a restraining order, or there has to be a restraint of evil. And the means to do that is the government will impose fear on those who will try to do things that are bad. And then here is something surprising. Regardless whether the ruler is a Christian, regardless if he is not a believer of God, but he says here, for he is God's servant for your good. Remember, Paul is a contemporary of Peter, and during that time, the emperor was Nero. He is God's servant for your good, and everything that is represented by Nero or the civil authorities. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God. There you go again. He is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on a wrongdoer. So let's dissect this slowly. This is what we call letting Scripture speak for itself. Okay? Part of that is also saying he is God's servant for your own good. So an example for that is in Esther chapter 6, verse 3. And the king said, what honor or distinction has been bestowed on Mordecai for this? The king's young men who attended him said, nothing has been done to them. So to get the context of this, this is the king Ahasuerus of Persia during the time of Esther. And we know Esther was the queen that was so beautiful. There was a beauty pageant. And then among those beautiful ladies, Esther was chosen to be the queen of King Ahasuerus. And one night, he was not able to sleep. And then, because he cannot sleep, maybe he wanted his men to give him a lullaby by reading something. So he instructed his people, "Can you go to my library and read the things that are happening before that was recorded?" And then the king's men said, "There is this name Mordecai who was able to foil a plot to abduct the king. It was you." And then he was not accorded recognition. So Mordecai did that, but the king forgot it. So what happened was then he was asking, "What honor or distinction has been bestowed to this Mordecai?" And said, wala pa. They were not able to recognize him. And then the story went on that Mordecai was given recognition. He was given a royal robe, a king's ring, and then he rode on the fine horses of the king. And then his enemy, by the name of Haman, who was persecuting Mordecai and the Jews during that time, he was the one who was saying, "Honor the king, the one who did something great for our king. We honor this man." And then that's it. So he was given recognition. And even during this time, we notice that the government also did that. We've heard about TOYM, 10 Outstanding Young Men of the Philippines, or 10 Outstanding Entrepreneurs of the Philippines, or 10 Young Scientists who are given recognition by the government. And that is another function that is expected of the government. Now, going further, "For he is God's servant for your own good, but if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain." So there is this word that is quite frightening, that even Christians will say, "Oh, that is not what the Word of God says." But let's study what Paul was saying. He was talking about, "Be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain." So meaning, the government is given a sword for a reason. It is not just for display. It is not just for scaring people. What does the sword mean? To bear the sword is to have the power of life and death. It is not for display only, but it will be used to execute laws. So during those times, a sword is not for cutting vegetables or meat and then you cook your food. That is not the purpose of a sword. A sword is a long knife used for battle to behead the enemy, to stab the enemy, purposely to mutilate and kill the enemy. And even during execution, it's used for beheading when the man is found guilty against the state. So the sword will be used for that. So the sword is used for execution of the law. So there's a saying among lawyers, dura lex sed lex, the law may be harsh, but the law is the law. So, okay, let's just proceed, no? Okay. At the same time, he is the servant of God and the avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Okay, just move on. Okay, what do you mean by avenger? This is not like a kind of movie like the Civil War. On one camp is Iron Man and on the other camp is Captain America and then they will fight each other. An avenger is coming from a root word, revenge. Okay, so when there is an oppression and there has to be a retribution or justice must be given, then it is not for us humans or for Christians to exact vengeance on our enemy, to cry out for justice. It is the government's role to exact vengeance because he is the avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. So siya yung gagawa. That's why we have the saying, do not take the law into your own hands. Okay? Huwag mong ilagay ang batas sa iyong sarili mga kamay. If somebody you want to take revenge, you will be a vigilante. Or you will do something outside the law, that is wrong, because God has instituted the civil authorities to exercise judgment, and that is given by God to the civil authorities. You notice this picture? Is this familiar to you? If there is the Statue of Liberty, there is also a statue of Lady Justice. On one hand is a weighing scale, on the other hand is the sword. Okay, and then her eyes are closed, and other versions of this, she is blindfolded. Okay, what's the meaning of this? In our justice system, we understand that it is a woman because she will delicately weigh the truth from the false, and then when the person is found guilty, he has to execute the law, even if it is harsh, by the sword. So you cannot see a lady justice just carrying a scale without a sword on the other hand. So when you are found guilty, then the sword will be given. So that's the avenger who will execute God's wrath on the wrongdoer. So we have this justice system, and it is exemplified by this figure, which is actually instructed and given in the Word of God. Okay, for such is the will of God, that by doing right, you may silence the ignorance of wrong men. So Peter was saying, if we are obeying, if we are submitting to the rules, to the civil authorities, you are silencing the ignorance and foolishness of men. So when we are doing right, okay, one of the best ways of meeting the accusations of our enemies is to lead a life of strict integrity that is not easy for the wicked to reply to this argument. So when we are living correctly, we are obeying, they have nothing to accuse of us except that we are Christians. For example, very, very simple example. Who among you here are driving your own cars? Can you raise your hands? Okay, so mga nagmamaneho. Or who among you here are paying your taxes? Raise your hands. Okay, so why? The rest are not paying their taxes? Okay, so when you are driving and then you know that there is a 60 kilometer per hour speed limit, and then you are the only one driving on a highway that is empty, okay, and then people are just standing there and then they see you, oh, why this guy is driving so slow, and then one car behind you is honking and you're pam, 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 why are you driving so slow? So they will accuse you, because he's driving slow, because he is a Christian and he is obeying the rules of the land. That's the only thing they can accuse of us, for Christians. For example, if there is a sign there, no littering, bawal magtapo ng basura in Tagalog, do not throw your garbage here. And then people will see that this guy, instead of throwing garbage, people are throwing garbage, this person will pick up the garbage and throw it properly in the garbage can. So they will not accuse you of anything, but they will accuse you because you're a Christian, because you are following the rules of the land. So people are silenced because we live a life submitting to civil authorities and to the law. Can I ask someone to assist to fix this? Okay. In verse 16, act as free men and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bondslaves of God. So Peter was saying, you are already freed from your sin. You have been born again already, and you have to live a life that is free. Yet the paradox is, do not use your freedom to what? Covering for evil, but use it as a bondslave of God. So Albert Barnes said, obey man's law as God's law. So when we see this 60 kilometers per hour, it doesn't mean that it is only a law of the land, but it has to be considered as God ordaining that law. Being citizens of the heavenly kingdom does not exempt us from our obligation to the laws of the land in which we live. Being free in Christ is not freedom from obedience to civil authorities. That's what he's saying. So when he's saying, bawal tumawid, do not cross here, go to the pedestrian, Go to the overpass. So as Christians, we do not violate the law. So somewhere here, after we go out after the service, so we do not cross. If we just look at if this is a pedestrian lane, then we can cross. Because being citizens of the heavenly kingdom does not exempt us from our obligation to the laws of the land. Because we are the people of God. We are a peculiar people. We are a holy nation. Okay? And then in the last verse, Peter said, honor all people. Yeah, thank you. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king. So Peter was saying, our submission to authorities will have a broad spectrum. So he's not simply saying here, you honor those in civil authorities. He's saying, honor all people. And then, love the brotherhood. So if they are Christians, you do good to them, especially, no? Especially when they're in the household of faith, especially if they are your brothers or they are your sister. And then he said, fear God. So when we fear God, we obey Him, we revere Him. And then, here's the most interesting part, honor the king. So remember, they are in a very oppressive government during that time, but Peter was still saying, honor the king. Okay? So, honor authority, be a blessing. So that is now our message this morning. So if we will try to read this, honor authority, be a blessing, will have a different and a deeper meaning only already. We're not simply saying, okay, I honor you, I honor you. It will only be words, but our honoring will mean submit, be obedient, voluntarily submit, be subjugated by God. Okay, now the question is, okay, we understand now, I am a Christian, how do I honor God? How do I submit to civil authorities? As a believer, what must be my foundation in order to submit? And what is the reason why am I going to submit? Okay, we have to understand that there are many views why people submit to God. But when we have the proper understanding of our relationship between God and civil authorities, then we'll be able to understand how to properly submit to these government authorities. One view is when people consider God alone is the authority. Okay, when people says God alone is the authority, so this is the picture. When God alone is the authority, the ellipse, the red ellipse, is the realm of God. And then on the other side, separate from God is civil authority. Thank you, brother. God bless you. Okay, so when God alone is the authority, meaning people will consider the civil authority as not part to be submitted to, because probably there is a perception of corruption in the civil authorities, and then they are illegitimate, okay, meaning the government was established by coup d'etat or by invasion or by cheating or what, and then they consider it's illegitimate. And then it's considered as weak and slow in delivering the basic services. It's not brilliant because the government is not a summa cum laude or not a PhD holder. And they won't submit because it's authoritarian and not meeting your expectations. So if you want to see something and you do not see them, so we'll say, oh, that government, I don't want to submit to the civil authorities, and that is why God alone is my authority. Probably that's quite right. But is that what the Lord is saying? No, it is not. Because when we have this understanding that God alone is the authority and we don't consider civil authorities as authority over us, we will have these wrong responses. Number one, we will live in distinct and separate communities. We will withdraw. We will go to the desert and put up monasteries. That's monasticism, meaning totally detached from the world. I have nothing to do, or as little as much as possible, little to do with the government. And then probably we'll say, because I don't like to be involved in the government, I will not join elections. I will not exercise suffrage. Or because they are corrupt, sila-sila yan, and I am clean, I am holy. I want to live a life that is holy. That's why I will not join politics. If we try to look at that, then we cannot influence the history of our nation. Another response is, have exclusive Christian friends. You don't want to befriend people who are in the government and work only for Christian companies. If this is a Christian company, this is not a Christian company, I will not work there. I will work here because God alone is my authority. And then probably we'll say, because God is my authority, I will not work in the government. Or because we don't agree with the government, we'll do protest march or rally marches. Ibagsak ang gobyerno. Ibagsak, ibagsak. How do you say that? Down with the government. Because I want God only to be my authority. And on the extreme, subvert authorities in the name of God. Okay? Subvert authorities in the name of God. Because the understanding is God alone is the authority. But Romans chapter 13, verse 1, it says here, let every person be subject to governing authorities. Whether we are single, married, whether we are pastors, priests, imams, bishops, or whatever rank we have, every person be subject to the governing authorities. In the King James Version, it's translated, every soul be subject to the governing authorities. Another view is government alone is the authority, meaning God has no place in that. So this is how I look at it. So God is irrelevant. Civil authorities is where I will submit. So civil authorities will be the only authority. And this is what happens when we say that the church or God is irrelevant. There is a misinterpretation or wrong interpretation of the separation of the church and the state. They're saying, oh, the church has nothing to do with the state. But is that what the Word of God says? No, it's not. So when people will say only civil authorities is the only authority and God has no place here, so what we are simply saying is God is forced out of the picture. We say, God, you are not part of this. And then God is seen as irrelevant. And then pragmatism rules. When you say pragmatic, when it works, when it is popular, then we will do it. Just like in America today, they are saying that they are creating a law against pastors who refuse to marry same-sex couples. They will say, the law will be against you if you will not allow same-sex couples to be married. Because the civil authority is the only authority. And right now, they are contemplating to pass laws saying that it is unlawful for ladies or for schools who will deny, profess gay, not to enter a ladies' restroom. Okay? So that is now, these are now the issues where God is separated from civil authorities. Separation of the church and the state does not mean separation of the church and God, because the state or civil authorities are established by God. So here is an example in Acts. About that time, Herod the king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. So this is the time when Herod was the civil authority. He killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter. So Herod, representing the government, this was during the days of the unleavened bread. And then, when he had seized him, he put him in prison, delivering him over to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending after the Passover to bring him out of the people. So Peter was kept in prison, but earnest prayer for him was made. So we picture here, Peter was incarcerated and then the believers were praying. Okay, the believers were praying. And then what happened next? And behold, an angel of the Lord stood next to him. And light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly." And the chains fell off his hands. When Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me." So we see here that Peter was imprisoned because of Herod. And then what happened next? After the rescue, and after Herod searched for him, referring to Peter, and did not find him, he examined the sentries and ordered that they should be put to death. So Peter escaped and he was not found, so Herod ordered the guards to be killed. Then he went down from Judea to Caesarea and spent time there. Then following on, in the same chapter, on the appointed day, Herod put on his royal robes, took his seat upon the throne, and delivered an oration. So he was an orator. He said something that was so beautiful, maybe like the speech of Patrick Ernest Henley when he said, "Give me death or give me liberty." Like those words, or "Invictus." And then the people were shouting, "The voice of God and not of men." Immediately, an angel of the Lord struck him down. So what we see here is Herod was claiming that he is God because he did not recognize or he did not acknowledge that it was because he's a king, but he's really a God to be worshipped. And then what happened next is the angel of the Lord struck him. Now, if we try to look at this picture, when Peter was in prison and then when he was rescued and then Herod died, it was not because people organized a rally and a march and say, "Release the political prisoner, Peter. Release him, release him." So they did not organize that rally. They just what? They just prayed. And then Herod died not because of mob action, but because the angel killed Herod. So what we see here is, as Christians, when we demand something, the only way to do that is to pray. That is why in 2 Chronicles 7:14, when we want our nation to grow and to be righteous, the only way for us believers to do is follow 2 Chronicles 7:14, which says, "If my people who are called by my name, first, humble themselves, second, pray, third, seek my face, fourth, turn from their wicked ways, and what's the result? I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and heal their land." So when we understand this, we don't have to cry out, rally on the streets, and then demand for something, for some change, because that is not what God wants us to do. What God wants us to do as believers is we humble and pray and seek and turn from our wicked ways, then God will hear and forgive our sins, and then He will heal our land. There will be change. There will be transformation. Now, gone are the days when people will consider a nation is always under God. Part of the Gettysburg Address, if you remember some of your high school oration or declamation, when Abraham Lincoln addressed the dead in Gettysburg, he says, 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal." So he was talking about the nation, and in the last part of his speech, Lincoln said that we here highly resolve that this dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. So Lincoln was really recognizing that a nation will always be under God. But today, people misunderstood or misrepresented or reinterpreted the separation of the church and the state, that the church or the church and the state is understood as separation between God and the state. But in Lincoln's time, no, the nation will always be under God. So how do we have the right understanding in relating to the government? So the third option is civil authorities are always under God. There is a church and there's a state. They are two distinct institutions that are answerable to God. So we have this picture. God and His realm, the universe, the earth, and then He established civil authorities for us to submit to. So civil authorities must be under God. And whatever temporal or physical laws the state has given us, we have to follow. And also at the same time, God will be talking to us the spiritual things by using the Holy Spirit, the Bible, the church, such as this. When we speak to you about the Word of God, then God is speaking to you on the spiritual and moral issues of life. But when we talk about civil laws, the law of the land, then that law of the land is also instituted and established by God. So here is how we look at things. Civil authorities are instituted by God and they are answerable to God. And we are answerable also to the civil authorities and at the same time to God. This is the right understanding. Okay? There is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. So there is always an order of things. In the same way, in verse 13, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution. So it's very, very clear. God established this, and we have to honor civil authorities by submitting to them. So what is our message this morning? Honor authority, be a blessing. Are you still with me so far? Okay, so let's move on. The question now is, let's put this in practical terms. How do we submit to civil authorities? What must be our basis? How is it founded? So let us have these simple things to remind us. No qualifications are made as to the kind of government to which we are to submit. Right? Okay? Very easy to submit to a democratic form of government. What if we are born in a totalitarian state? What if we were born in North Korea? What if we were born in the former Socialist Republic of Russia? Is it a prerequisite that in order for us to submit, the government must first be according to our liking, our qualification? No. Peter says, every institute, every government established by God. So the kind of government is not a qualification for believers to submit. And we are just so blessed that we are living in a country such as the Philippines and all other democratically founded countries because it's easy to submit. But that doesn't mean that if you are in a totalitarian state, you don't submit. And that is why Christians in oppressive regime grow so fast because people really see the truthfulness, the authenticity of their Christianity by submitting even to harsh rulers. And here in the Philippines, in other democratic countries, we are given the opportunity to submit willingly but not compulsively. Number two, do not make the performance of government officials the basis for whether or not we submit to civil authorities. So now we are in the election fever. We don't say, I won't submit to this government because this government is so slow in delivering the basic services to the poor regions of this country. I won't submit. I won't pay my taxes. That's not what the Word of God says. The Word of God says, submit to all authorities. Do not make the performance of the government officials the basis of our submission. The question now is, when am I going not to submit? Because sometimes we see that the government is doing something wrong and I still have to submit. So here it is. Only when obedience to God is forbidden by government that we don't submit. So when God tells us to obey on something, then if the government tells, do not obey God, then we will obey God rather than the government. And what are these two instances? Actually, there are only two. Forbid to preach the gospel. So if the government will say, do not preach the gospel, do not share the word, the Bible about Christ, gospel and salvation, then we have to disobey the government. In Acts 4, 13 to 14, now when they, the civil authorities, saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished and they recognized they had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. So what happened here was, when there was a crippled man healed, and then there was ruckus in the city, there was parang nabigla yung mga tao doon. Why is this crippled man for years now healed? And then the government or the civil authorities was amazed. Okay, they investigated. And then when they investigated, they saw the man healed beside Peter and John. So what they did was, so they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. Because Peter and John was saying, this man was healed because of Jesus Christ who rose from the dead. And then the civil authorities were saying, do not preach this Jesus anymore. Wag ka na mag-Jesus, Jesus. But what happened? But Peter and John answered to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. So what is right? To listen to you or to listen to God? So you be the judge. Knowing that these civil authorities are Jewish leaders, they understand that it is better to listen to God. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. So they have to tell the gospel. And so they went out. Even they were already told not to preach the gospel. And then when they preached, they were rearrested again. And then when they were rearrested again, the angel rescued them again. And then they were found there in the synagogues and in places preaching the gospel. And then the council called them again. And when they had brought them after rearresting and then in prison and then went back again, and the high priest questioned them, saying, we strictly charge you not to teach this name, Jesus, yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. But Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than man. So that's the only instance where we can disobey God, when God will muscle us from preaching the word of God, then we can disobey Him. We can disobey them. But other civil laws, we must submit to them. What other instance that we can disobey the government? When it contradicts Christian morals and conduct. So when the Ten Commandments says, honor your father and mother, for this is the first commandment with the promise, then when the government will say, do not honor your father and mother, then we will disobey. If the Ten Commandments will tell us, do not murder, then the government will say, murder your people. Then we will disobey. But the government does not do that. In fact, the government protects people from getting killed or stealing or lying. So when it talks about contradiction of morals, then those are the two things where we can limit our obedience to the government. Okay, example. And he, the king of Egypt, said, when you are helping the Hebrew women to give birth during the time of Moses and see them upon the birthstool, if it is a son or if it is a boy, then you shall put him to death. But if it is a daughter, then she shall live. But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them. It's very clear. Do not murder. So they did not obey the king. Okay, but when they did not obey the king, they treat the governing authorities with respect, even in disobedience. So when we disobey people, we still have to honor them when the disobedience is really founded on these two conditions only. Example in Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods and worship the golden image? So he was talking even to his cabinet secretaries. Okay? Nebuchadnezzar and these three people, young men who are given the wisdom from God, are his cabinet secretaries, and he was asking them, is it true that you're not worshiping my God? But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into the burning fiery furnace, and who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands? So he was challenging them. And what did these three young men said? If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. He's not saying, well, if we will disobey you, we will disrespect you. No. They were still addressing them as, O king, But if not, be it known to you, O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image. So even in our disobedience, when we disobey some rules that the government is telling us against morals, we still have to remain respectful. Okay? Okay ba yun? Mabigat, ano? But that's true. Okay, submit to civil authorities based on the sovereignty of God. So this is something we have to contemplate and reflect upon. Submit to civil authorities based on the sovereignty of God. We are born, many of us are born Filipinos, and that is why we have this country. Many of the people before us were born during the time of Emperor Nero. Many of the Germans were born in the time of Nazi occupation Germany, like Hitler. Many were born in the time of Stalin, the time of Lenin. Many were born in the time of Mao Zedong. Many were born in the time of the killing fields in Cambodia. We cannot choose the generation when we are born. But it is God's sovereignty that we were born in such situation. The reason is God is sovereign above all. And when the government does things that are not according to what we desire, it is still according to the sovereignty of God, and we still have to submit to civil authorities. Let's have an example. When Jesus Christ himself was facing Pilate, he was saying, "You, Pilate, have no authority over me unless it has been given to you from above." So even Jesus Christ, when he was condemned to die on the cross, he was simply saying, "You would have no authority over me unless it has been given to you from above." So he was simply saying, "Pilate, you have authority over me," even if he is already the Son of God, and he will be brought to die on the cross. Look at this. The government achieves God's purposes when it fails to carry out its divinely given task. Even if the government fails to deliver its divinely appointed task, it still achieves God's purposes. Even if we want a perfect and an ideal government, and if it does not happen, still God achieves his purposes. When God allows government to persecute Christians, talking about the time of Peter and Paul and all the apostles, for doing well rather than to praise them, even then his purposes are being accomplished. So even when they were persecuted because they preached the name of Jesus Christ, it still accomplished the purposes of God. Let's go to Acts 4 to prove my point. When they were released from prison, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God and said, "Sovereign Lord." So when they were already released, no? "Who made the heaven and sent and the earth and the sea and everything in them?" He was talking to God when they were persecuted. "Who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit, 'Why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain?'" He was saying, look at these unbelievers. They're persecuting us in vain. "The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed one." They are gathered together to crucify Christ, to persecute Christ and his followers. They understand that. "For truly in this city there were gathered together against you, against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the people." Now here it is. "To do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place." So even the persecution of the believers were already predestined to take place. Without the persecution of the Christians during that time, there will be no scattering. The message will be in Jerusalem only. But when there was persecution, the message was brought to India, to South Africa, even to Europe, even to Asia. And now we are recipients of the persecution of the Christians before, because God allowed it, even with an evil government. So we have to submit on that, that whatever happens to us, even if our government is never perfect, there is always a sovereign decree only open in the eyes and the mind of God. And all the Christians have to do is just to submit wherever we are. And the only time we will never submit is when we are not, or when we are forbidden to preach the word of God, or when it is contradictory to Christian morals and values. Those are the only things. But other things, whether from the simple, no littering, speed limit, taxes, we have to submit to the civil authorities because it was instituted by God. And when we do that, when we are persecuted, we should not be surprised. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So Christians will always be married to persecution. But remember, persecution is only in this world. When the time has come, because God said it is appointed for man to die once and after that is judgment, then we will be facing our great King, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the eternal God. Then our persecution will be nothing because we will hear again those precious words, "Thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master." And then we will be with him forever, where there will be no tears, there will be no pain, there will be no aching, there will be no heartaches. It will always be bliss, it will always be joy. So that whatever we experience here for standing what is right and what is godly, they are incomparable to what we will have forever in the presence of God. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Okay, so going back, honor authority and be a blessing. So let me pose some questions here to be more practical. How do you obey the speed limits we have here in Davao City and soon to be the entire country? Do you see yourself glorifying God as you obey it, or do you find yourself forced by circumstance to obey? Like for example, if you're driving at 80 kilometers and you know that later on in that intersection there will be traffic enforcers who will be pointing a gun on you to check your speed, and then you suddenly slow down. Or maybe you're in a red light, traffic light intersection, and then you see, oh, there are no cars here, I'm the only one, but still it's red, so maybe it's justified to go and disrespect the traffic light. Are you compelled, or do you see that when you obey the law of the civil authorities, you are also obeying God's law? And that makes the Christian distinct from the unbelieving world. When people will see that we have a life of obedience, then people will be brought to God because our life is truly different. How do you pay your taxes to the government? Do you justify not properly paying taxes because there is so much corruption in the government? In Cebuano, if we try to talk about taxes, people will say, istoryahe in Bisaya, or tell that to the Marines in English. Don't talk to me about taxes because they will just enjoy and fill their pockets of the taxes that we pay. Paying taxes is different from governments using the funds. But as people, God's law, man's law, they're just the same. Now, Christian submission does not fall short of secular submission as it far surpasses it. The Christian is to obey civil authorities whether they are looking or not. So when we have these laws on the land, we are not just obeying simply by obeying. We surpass it even. Like the law, you shall not murder. See, we're not simply saying we shall not murder by not stabbing people or hurting people or killing people. We're simply saying we do not murder them in our minds by getting angry at them. We are even forgiving because Christians must surpass in obeying the law because we are obeying a higher law, even when people are not looking at us. Now, here is something more relevant. How do you look at the outgoing president, the vice president, and other leaders? People will call names. I don't want to say it. Otherwise, I will not be honoring them based on 1 Peter 2:17. Honor all people, honor the king. We don't like the president. Remember, the president, the vice president, the senators, and everyone sitting on those positions are still government or civil authorities until June 30, 12 noon. So they are to be honored. And what about if you are against the incoming new set of leaders? You will call him names. whatever names you want to call him, but he will be, and his cabinet and everyone will be leaders of our country. The question now is, maybe our hands are filled with blood at the moment. But I challenge you that as believers, we may not be perfect. We may commit mistakes. We may disrespected people here and there, even in our Facebook, in our Twitter, in our whatever accounts, in our blogs. But as Christians, we know that we are serving a God. And when we serve God, we will honor people who are instituted by Him. So we only come to Him and say, Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. This is wrong. And God says, if you confess your sins, He is just and faithful to forgive you of our sins and cleanse you from all your unrighteousness. Come to God again. God requires Christians to show honor to those in authority, whether we voted for them or not. So this is just very near to the recently concluded election. So whether we voted for them or not, we have to honor them. We have to honor them. Because we are a peculiar people, a holy nation, a chosen race, a possession of God. So that when people see that we are living a life so distinct, they will be so attracted. And then they will see, what is that thing that you have that I do not have? Why is it that you are so obedient and I am not? You know, the word obedience, subjugation, and submission is very, very difficult. But when our hearts are transformed by the power of God's Word, by His Holy Spirit, then these words will be true to us. We will be easily submitting to God and His Word. And when we are truly submitted to God's Word, we will see that ourselves will become a blessing to others. But for those of you who have this difficulty in submitting, I have good news for you. You only need to come to the Lord. If your heart is full of rebellion, full of resistance even to the authorities like your parents in school, in your employers, God has a good news for you. He said, come to me, all who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. When God puts us under civil authorities, that burden is light. Because we know that God will use His children to change the world. God will use you, and me, and every one of us here to change the world, not by changing it upside down by force, but changing the world by attraction, by changing the hearts of people, bringing Christ in the hearts of each one. Isn't it wonderful that we have that kind of God? Can you say amen? Amen. Okay, let us all please rise and let's thank the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this wonderful morning that you have given us. We pray, dear God, that as we have heard your word, we will not only be listeners of your word, but we will be doers of your word. Thank you, dear God, that you have established authorities, and we are thankful that we are in this country, that there is democracy where we can express and share our faith, and our morals, our values, our Christian conduct is never thwarted or never oppressed by this government. And that is why to honor and to please you, to obey you as our Lord and Savior, we will obey and submit ourselves to the civil authorities. Once again, O Lord, bless your people. Show your favor upon each one of us. Let each one of us exude that power that Jesus has brought upon our hearts. People will be blessed when we always follow you. Thank you once again. For all of this we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody will say, amen. Let us give a clap offering to God.